Bradford, it's good to see you again. I thought you'd forgotten it.
Oh, never that, Joe. It's marvelous to be here.
Come this way.
So many people know me. I wish I did. I wish someone would tell me about me.
My father drank himself to death. My mother lives in Paris. I take a great deal of exercise. I'm accustomed to a reasonable quantity of tobacco and alcohol. I'm said to have a sense of humor.
I never knew from day to day who my mother was. It shook me nervous.
I wonder if you can guess who I am.
What a dump. Sorry.
Come on, Oscar. Let you and me get drunk.
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
The American Film Institute cordially invites you to join in the celebration honoring Bette Davis in a program starring Olivia de Havilland, Peter Falk, Geraldine Fitzgerald, Henry Fonda, Lee Grant, Paul Henry, Celeste Holm, Joseph L. Mankiewicz, Martin Manulis, Liza Minnelli, George Stevens Jr., Cicely Tyson, Robert Wagner, Natalie Wood, William Wyler, and hosting tonight's program, Jane Fonda. Ladies and gentlemen, our guest of honor, Bette Davis. Ladies and gentlemen, Jane Fonda.
Welcome. I can't think of a better way to begin this evening than by mentioning a few titles, like Petrified Forest, Of Human Bondage, All About Eve, Dangerous, Dark Victory, The Little Foxes, Now Voyager, and Jezebel. I'm honored to be here tonight at the 5th American Film Institute Life Achievement Award, paying tribute to the star of all those films and almost 80 others. My connection with Bette Davis is a little oblique. During the filming of Jezebel, my father's contract guaranteed that he would be through with his job and back in New York in time for my birth. What this must have caused in the way of problems for the actors and the director and the writer, I can't imagine. But Bette Davis won her second Academy Award in spite of what I unintentionally put her through. My second relationship with Bette Davis is one that I share with everyone in our industry and audiences everywhere in the world, an appreciation of her total contribution to motion pictures. And so tonight, we honor this most remarkable woman, Bette Davis. Bette Davis, who throughout a long and distinguished career has redefined the words actress and star, and along the way, a few other words like fighting and winning. And so the American Film Institute pays tribute to Bette Davis. And may I introduce to you tonight's spokeswoman for the American Film Institute's Board of Trustees, Cicely Tyson.
Each year, the trustees of the American Film Institute select an individual who, in some fundamental way, has advanced the art of film, whose work has stood the test of time, and who, by that work, has enriched American culture. In accepting our Life Achievement Award, Bette Davis now joins the previous recipients, John Ford, James Cagney, Orson Welles, and William Wyler. As inevitable as it may be to recognize distinguished filmmakers, that is only a part of what the American Film Institute stands for. The other part is the conviction by those of us who make and love film that our industry has grown in less than a century from the corner Nickelodeon to a major cultural power. We acknowledge the responsibilities of that power, the preservation of the fine films of the past, the encouragement of the fine films that are still to come, and above all, a deep and undying devotion that can occasionally help a work of craft become a work of art. That is why the American Film Institute was formed, and that is why I'm extremely proud to be a part of it. And now, I look forward in the course of this evening to watching with you memorable scenes and performances in over half of the 80 films in the career of Bette Davis. Thank you.
Cicely. In 1931, Bette Davis made her first film, Bad Sister. It was something less than a star-making vehicle. Six rather similar films later, the highly and greatly respected George Arliss was to keep her from leaving Hollywood forever by casting her in The Man Who Played God. It was her first important role. And within six short years, she proved that she could be a star in Of Human Bondage, and then won two Academy Awards, one for Dangerous and the other for Jezebel. She had begun a career that would span five decades, and its end is not yet in sight.
You know, Laura, you'd make some man a wonderful wife.
Oh, I'll never marry.
Why not?
Oh, many reasons. In the first place, oh, I don't know. Guess I've never found any man I could really fall in love with.
Well, I'm not surprised. I don't know anybody that'd be good enough for you.
Now, Dick.
Oh, I mean that.
Would you like a cup of coffee?
Say, would I?
Just wait, Laura, take a minute. I can learn more from you in 5 minutes than from anyone else in 5 years.
You love music, don't you?
I love you. I love you.
Grace, my dear child.
I'm not a child.
But you...
Don't you love me at all?
Of course I love you. But I'm old and easily flattered. I'm moved by your youth and beauty and emotion.
I love that music. Whenever I hear it, I think of you. How pale you are. How strange, how cold.
You are going. Do you always order champagne?
I was hoping it would make you more friendly. Do you think it will?
Well, there's one thing I can say for you. Gentlemen, in every sense of the word.
You're so very fascinating, and I'm asking you to forgive me for what I'm saying now, if I hurt you.
Hurt me? You delight me. You have the most amazing lack of humor of anyone I've ever known. Oh, I should laugh at you, should I, but I can't help it. You were so awkward that I almost laughed in your face at first, and then it made me quite sick to think that anyone could be stupid enough to be taken in by a lot of old tricks. I thought you might at least be amusing, but you turned out to be dull and stupid and so afraid. Well, you needn't be. I won't hurt your Sunday school romance or your oh-so-nice career. Hurt me? Get out of here before you give me hysterics!
Press, what fools we were.
Julie, you're lovely. Lovelier than ever.
Press, I can't believe it's you here. I've dreamed about it so long. A lifetime. No. Longer than that. I put on this white dress for you. To help me tell you how humbly I ask you to forgive me. Press, I'm kneeling to you. Ask you to forgive me and love me as I love you.
Julie, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, Henry Fonda.
Betty, I hope you appreciate that it takes two Fondas to salute one Davis. I first met Betty long before either of us was in the professional theater. And since between us, we've logged almost 100 years' experience. You can figure out the date for yourself. The mother of a friend of mine in Omaha asked me if I would go east to drive home with her son from Princeton to keep him company. And in return for this, she would give me a week in New York. And I jumped at the chance because I'd never been east of the Mississippi, not much further west, as a matter of fact. And I went to New York and I saw 9 glorious plays in 6 days. My friend picked me up Saturday night to drive to Princeton for a weekend before we left on a trip, and in the car with him was a Mrs. Davis and her 2 daughters, about 16 and 17 years old, named Bobby and Betty. I remember we drove through a pea fog all the way to Princeton, but we got there, and the girls and their mother went to the Nassau Inn, and I spent the night with my friend in his dormitory. It gets a little embarrassing here. My friend was a very juvenile type, and he suggested to me that we have a kind of a game on our long trip and see who could kiss the most girls. And there'd be some sort of a prize at the end of the trip. In spite of my painful shyness at the time, I agreed because I figured I was hired to go along with him. On Sunday, after dinner, Mrs. Davis, we left her at the hotel and we drove with the girls to the Princeton Stadium, where Hunter got out with Bobby and my friend. Got out with Bobby and left me in the back seat with Betty. I'd learned that my friend was pinned to Bobby, and that's an expression they used in those days. And I knew damn well that he was kissing her in that empty stadium in the moonlight and making points. Now, if I tell you that in college, I dated a girl steady for 2 years and never kissed her, you will understand my predicament sitting in that back seat. I don't think I put my arm around her, but I finally gave her a little tentative kiss to keep the score even. Next day, we put the girls and their mother on the train for Boston, and before my friend and I left Princeton for the trip, I got a letter from Betty that she must have written on the train and mailed at the Grand Central Station, and she said that she told her mother, and her mother would announce the engagement when they got home. Betty was 3 years later when I was the third assistant stage manager, and she was an apprentice at the Cape Playhouse on Cape Cod. And I often walked her home from the theater at night. We'd sit in the screen porch and drink lemonade. You know something? She never mentioned that kiss.
When Bette Davis arrived in Hollywood after a rather successful career on Broadway, Universal sent a car to pick her up at the train station, but the studio representative said that he didn't recognize her because, according to him, she didn't look like an actress. And Bette said in the first of what was to become a long string of straightforward statements, "I had a dog with me. You should have known I was an actress." The legend, or rather the lack of it, persisted, and around the studio in an era when blonde was beautiful, she was called the Little Brown Wren. But 3 years and 21 films later, there came of Human Bondage. And from then on, the Little Brown Wren proved that she could fly as high as any other. There evolved on the screen a new kind of woman, self-willed and free-spirited. And ever since, the independent woman has been a part of screen's vocabulary of heroines. And nowhere has courage and spunk and pride been more evident than in these performances that you're going to see by the very independent Bette Davis.
Why, Robin, you know you can't wear red for the Olympic ball.
Can't I?
I'm going to. This is 1852, Dumplin. 1852, not the Dark Ages.
Girls don't have to simper around in white just because they're not married.
Would you like to marry a Frenchman?
Oh, I don't want to ever marry.
No?
I want to be always free.
I see. I'm just about fed up with sneaking in.
Sneaking?
Yes, sneaking. Let's get married. So I'll have the right to be with you.
What do you mean, right? I don't like the word right.
Let's not quibble about words.
No, I'm not quibbling. Right means something. No one has any rights about me, except me.
I want to marry you.
Oh, Don, we've been over it. Over it and over it. I want to wait from home to be on my own. I don't want to be like my mother, a yes woman for some man. I want to be a person on my own. What can I do?
You can be our inspiration.
You mean stand by and look pretty? No, I want to do more than that. Couldn't I learn the business?
Shoe business?
Yes. Lots of women are earning big money in executive positions.
Well, that's an idea.
I'm going to prove I'm as good a reporter as any man.
This business of being a newspaper woman, why, that's kid stuff. You don't have to work.
No, but... Well, I want to prove I can be as good a reporter as...
Now, look, we could get one of those studio apartments or the fireplace and... Well, what else would you want?
I'm extremely happy the way things are.
Well, how are things?
I'm successful. I have a certain stature in my work, a considerable amount of money in the bank, and I do pretty well as I please,
for male companionship.
But a woman's only future is to marry and fulfill the duties.
Nonsense. I'd have made a shocking wife anyway.
But haven't you ever been in love?
I have never talked to a man for more than 5 minutes in my life without wanting to box his ears.
Oh, you're incredible, utterly incredible, perched up on that pinnacle of masculine ego, looking down at poor, weak, defenseless females and pitying them. But they don't have beards.
Had a beard, I wouldn't look at you twice.
Very amusing and a typical male reaction to intellectual defeat.
Me, intellectually defeated.
I've run into that attitude before. Every woman does the minute she starts to make a career for herself. Get back to the kitchen, Mother. The man's world.
All I want to do is to find out where I stand with you, and all of a sudden I'm knee-deep in the battle of the sexes. What is this?
Right from the beginning, you refused to follow instructions because I'm a woman and not to be taken seriously.
You're a successful woman. I ought not to like it.
You're a pretty successful man. I ought not to like it.
I'm a man. At Bette Davis's table tonight is a director about whom she once said, "If I have one ambition left before I give up this murderous career, it's to make just one more picture with Willie Wyler." He directed her in Jezebel, in The Letter, and in The Little Foxes, and he was last year's recipient of the AFI Life Achievement Award, William Wyler.
As you know, I had the great good fortune to direct Bette in 3 films. I'm often asked, was she difficult? I say no. Was she easy? I say no. What I mean is, she was difficult, but not in the usually accepted sense. She was difficult in the same way that I was difficult. She wanted the best. And to get it, nothing was too much trouble. Sometimes she wanted more takes on a scene than even I did. One line of dialogue. We disagreed strongly on how it should be read. Even today, 37 years later, we still disagree on it. Well, Bette read it the way I asked her to. But I'm sure she would like nothing better right now than to drive over to Warner Brothers and reshoot the scene her way. No one I know brought more heart and devotion, more energy, honesty, integrity, ability, and professionalism, more sheer damn hard work to a marvelous career than she did. And I'm happy and grateful to have had a small part in it. To you, Bette, my admiration and my love, always. And that's a take.
Natalie Wood and Robert Wagner.
When I was about 11 years old, I'd been acting for some time, and pretty much going from one picture to the other and playing somebody's child, and pretty much doing what I was told. But when I was told that in the next picture, the leading lady was going to be Bette Davis, I was absolutely thrilled to get the chance to work with her. The picture was called The Star, and somehow I never got introduced to The Star, although I was playing her daughter. So the first day, we were filming on Sterling Hayden's sailboat, and all of a sudden it turned out that I had to jump off the boat and swim to a faraway raft. So there I was, faced with the threat of being flung into the ocean or losing the part, and I went into hysterics that must have been heard all the way to Catalina. In any case, Miss Davis certainly heard them, and she came out of her dressing room to find out what all the commotion was. This was the only time that I ever saw the famous Bette Davis temperament surface, and it was not on her own behalf. But she did tell the director that she wouldn't stand around while he threw some terrified kid into the ocean. And that if he'd wanted a swimmer, he should have gotten Johnny Weissmuller. I never saw her again for quite a few years. And then, at a party, I spotted her across the room, and I wanted to go over to her and remind her of the incident and thank her. And then I thought, oh, well, it was a long time ago, and I had a small part, and she probably won't remember. So anyway, I didn't. And a little while later, somebody tapped me on the shoulder, and I turned around, and it was Betty, and she said, I'm sure you don't remember me, but we worked together once.
I was in a story with Bette Davis a few years ago, and I had a line at the end of the film, which I constantly repeat to her whenever I see her, because it's so very, very true. And the line is, lady, you're beautiful, just beautiful.
Geraldine Fitzgerald.
The reason that I came from New York to Hollywood tonight is Bette Davis. And the reason that I came to Hollywood in 1939 was Bette Davis. In the case tonight, to join everybody to pay tribute to her, and in 1939 to be in a film called Dark Victory. Now, I was told that I must be very careful of her because although she might seem to have total integrity as an actress, in fact, she was only interested, they said, in getting her face in front of the camera. So they said, you must watch out all the time. If she smiles at you, if her character smiles at your character, she's only trying to dazzle you so you won't notice that you're in the dark. If her character walks towards your character, it's because she's going to get in front of you with the camera. And above all, they said, if her character extends a friendly hand to you or catches you by the shoulders, it isn't her character being friendly to your character. She's turning you away from the camera. Well, I was terrified. I said, this is my first film in Hollywood. What'll I do? And they said, the only thing to do is to look for a piece of furniture in the scene and somehow get yourself wedged behind it so she can't move you around. So I didn't really hold on to this idea for more than about the first half day's work together. But I did notice when I saw Dark Victory recently that there is one place in the early sequence where I do seem to be clinging onto a table rather desperately. In fact, Bette Davis was the most positive feature in my career. She really started me off, her kindness and her goodness and her generosity. And you know, it's an amazing thing to think about because we're all used to the idea of a mature person wanting to hand on what they know to a younger person or help a younger person. But this was a young girl who was that generous to everybody. She was celebrated for starting people's careers. And therefore, with great love and respect, I salute a great artist. And I am truly proud to be in this large congregation of her lovers and admirers. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Falk.
I'm here tonight as someone whose career just brushed up against Bette Davis's for one brief moment. We made one picture together in 1961, Frank Capra's Pocketful of Miracles. And I only had one scene with Bette, and I only had one line in it, and it wasn't a very memorable line. And it wasn't even to her, it was about her. And the line was, I looked at her and I said, what's this?
Uh,
When I made Pocketful of Miracles, I'd only been out in Los Angeles for a matter of months. It was the very first Hollywood film. Prior to that, I was knocking around off-Broadway, and there was a lot of difference between those stages on the Lower East Side and working out here. And I don't know about other New York actors, but I felt like a fish out of water, and I had strange notions about Hollywood stars. I remember I was awed by them and intimidated by them and felt superior to them and envious of them, and I didn't think they could act, and I made fun of them, and I wanted to be one all at the same time. And I remember how comfortable Bette Davis made me feel, and she didn't even talk to me. I mean, I just heard her talking when I went on the set. And while in my mind she was a legend, in person she was an actress. But there's yet another side of Bette's career, and that's the beautiful love scenes that were part of so many of her films. And though sometimes the language was flowery and the attitudes a little simple, there was nothing quite like Bette in love.
I'm giving a party too, a big one, Saturday night. I got a jazz band coming up from Memphis.
Well, that's fine.
I want you to come and be my boyfriend.
Oh, I'd be glad to, Madge.
Cute. I'd like to kiss you, but I just washed my hair.
Was it a nice wedding?
Usual thing. Do you? I do. Kiss the bride, have some cake.
That's a good idea.
What?
Kiss the bride. Why do I love you?
Because I am so beautiful. I
always have the feeling you're laughing at me, and I find that attractive. Besides the fact you're very rich. Would you like to kiss me?
But darling, darling, say it again.
No. You say something nice to me.
Dearest, I think you're the lowest thing that ever crawled. As long as I can reach out and get my hands on you, no other man will ever touch me.
Thank you. Thank you. Your husband.
Here you are.
Oh, I'm not hungry. You eat them all. I'm going down to do some work on the ship. Joan will be very happy to help you with the dishes, Pop. Goodbye, dear. Say, that's the way Eskimos kiss.
Do you believe in immortality?
I don't know. Do you?
I want to believe that there's a chance for such happiness to be carried on somehow, somewhere.
Are you so happy, then?
Charlotte, won't you be honest and tell me that you are happy, too? Since the night on the boat when you told me about your illness, I can't get you out of my mind. Nor out of my heart, either. If I were free, there would be only one thing I want to do. Prove you're not immune to happiness. Would you want me to prove it, Charlotte? Tell me you would. Then I'll go. My darling, you are crying.
Oh, I'm such a fool. Such an old fool. These are only tears of gratitude. an old maid's gratitude for the crumbs off it.
Don't talk like that.
You see, no one ever called me darling before.
Henry. I'm here tonight as Bette Davis's friend and fellow smoker. Someone with whom she shared some very important cigarettes. You just saw what appeared to be my younger brother lighting the two cigarettes in our boiler. That particular business was not in the original script. The original called for a lot of shoving of cigarettes back and forth between Betty and me. It seemed very, very awkward. But to light two at the same time, I thought that would be meaningful and romantic too. So I suggested it to Betty, who loved it, and we worked it out between us. Then we went to our director, who shall be nameless. And I said, Irving, how about if we did it like this? Well, in the course of the great tradition of directors, he wasn't quite sure about it, so he said no. However, our marvelous producer, Hal Wallis, he liked it, and that's how it happened. That, of course, was only a minor skirmish compared to some of the other battles that are fought in our business. Starting with my first makeup test, when the studio, after just seeing me in Joan of Paris, wanted me to look like George Brent, and I ended up looking like George Raft. Even back then, Betty stood up for me. She had had to fight for the real Betty to come through, and she fought just as hard for the real me. My adoration of her was instantaneous and has never, never wavered. It's extraordinary now when I look back at my life. I think of the hundred of times my home was filled with people drinking and eating and doing all things that people do together in the name of friendship. And then I think how few of them were there when any of us needed their help. The great Betty was the exception. Her friendship has been a marvelous, warm possession, as dear to my wife and me as our family itself. For this, as much as for her greatness as an actress, and her genius, I worship her, and I thank her.
It's no wonder that All About Eve was and still is one of those rare, magical, and beautiful films. And here is its remarkable writer and director, Joseph Mankiewicz.
Oddly enough, our first meeting, Betty's and mine, did not take place until April 1950. On All About Eve, it was our first conference. I'd actually never set eyes on, much less met her, before. And that wasn't very odd, because at that time the film world was a very small one, but it was very sharply separated into separate, sharply demarcated, and zealously guarded duchies. And as Jane pointed out, since 1931, Betty had been an indentured serf, first to Lord Lemley of Universum, and then to the Warner Barons, who had their duchy in the faraway valley, San Fernando. In my case, and stars like Davis and Cagney, stars like Crawford and Gable, they, unless by permission or by command of the All High, they had somewhat less freedom of professional mobility, I would say, than Andrei Sakharov has in Russia today. You could go for years without meeting anyone from another duchy. But anyway, by 1950, a lot had happened. And a lot of it not very good for the duchies. There were little leaks here and there. And for one, Miss Davis had been emancipated, miraculously escaped through the Burbank minefields and over the wall to the west. Actually, with Kurt Bernhardt, she was doing a film called Payment on Demand, a studio called RKO, kind of a smallish studio, which it seems nobody ever wanted to own for more than a week. And you wonder why I work so little. My producer, the elder Mr. Zanuck, had, however, slyly and secretly, sent my screenplay of All About Eve to Betty Davis, perhaps in code, by hand, just in case. Betty Davis had read it, and Betty Davis wanted it. I suppose over the years, I've been, and I continue to be, luckier than most directors in having superior and responsible acting talents as collaborators, but never more fortunate than in All About Eve. Working with Betty, it goes without saying, from the first day to regrettably our last, was an experience as happy and rewarding as any I've ever known. Barring possibly grand opera, I cannot think of anything beyond her scope. To this day, my greatest and deepest regret is that I hadn't worked with her before Eve, and I haven't since. Bless you, Betty.
Ladies and gentlemen, Celeste Holm.
I love the definition of acting. Betty said, pray to God and say the lines. That's acting. Off screen, Betty never indulged in pretense or affectation. And God help anybody around her who did. But when she played a villainess, she made it clear that a villainess is not a villainess to herself. She's just someone doing the best she can with whatever she's stuck with. To watch Betty Davis be evil, mean, vicious, and nasty was to see villainy at its very best. But despite her villainy, or maybe because of it, she remains a heroine to every aspiring young actress in the world.
I made you rich. I put those dog clothes on your back. Now, just because you got your neck washed, you think you're a gentleman. Nobody can make you that. You're a riffraff, and so am I. You belong to me, and you're going to stay with me. Just that, you're going to stay with me because I'm holding on to you. Well, I committed murder to get you.
Give me that nonsensical object.
Oh, you cheap, petty bookkeeper, you. Every time I think that those soft, sticky hands of yours ever touched me, it makes me sick.
Sick, do you hear? You're everything that's repulsive to me. Your wife. I've never been a wife to you, you poor simpering fool. If you had any pride, if you were a man instead of a drooling milksop, you'd throw me out and be ashamed to admit that you'd ever married me.
I want you to marry me.
I might even turn out to be a good wife. Imagine me being a good wife.
You don't care what happens to me any more than the others. You let me go to prison. All you're thinking of is your own miserable life. Well, you can die for all I care. Die!
I hope you die. I hope you die soon. I'll be waiting for you to die.
I'm bad for people. I don't mean to be, but I can't help myself. So I'm being generous to you, Don. Kind. Kinder than I've ever been to anybody before. But I can't be much longer.
And I know what you're trying to do.
But I'm not trying to do anything. Honestly, Jane.
You disgust me.
Me? I disgust you. 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 You're too fine. You won't have none of me, but you'll sit here all night looking at your naked females.
Mildred.
You cad. You dirty swine. I never cared for you, not once. I was always making a fool of you. You bored me stiff. I hated you. It made me sick when I had to let you kiss me. I only did it because you begged me. You hounded me. You drove me crazy. And after you kissed me, I always used to wipe my mouth. Wipe my mouth. But I made up for it. For every kiss, I had a laugh. We laughed at you. Miller and me and Griffiths and me. We laughed at you because you were such a mug, a mug, a mug. You know what you are, you gimpy leg monster. You're a cripple, a cripple, a cripple.
Ladies and gentlemen, Olivia de Havilland.
Betty had the career I most admired. It was the career I wanted to have, because she was a pioneer, a revolutionary, in that she wanted to play real human beings, good and bad, lovely or ugly, whereas I fear most actresses wanted only to be beautiful and romantic, but not Betty. She was the only young actress to combine character work with stardom. All actors and actresses want the Academy Award. Betty won two. And later on, so did I. I must say this. If I owe mine to anyone, I owe them to Betty. She was the inspiration of my career. And I'm thrilled that she is the first woman to be honored in this way. It's so appropriate.
ladies and gentlemen, Liza Minnelli.
An explosive little broad with a sharp left. That was what Jack Warner, one of the things that he said about Miss Bette Davis. As head of the studio, he didn't have to really deal with her as an actress. He slugged it out with Davis the fighter. And she fought him over scripts and over her rights as an artist, on soundstage, even in the courts. And she won. She's been a fighter all of her career. You're about to see a few of her trophies. Each of them represented an Oscar nomination. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner and still champion, Bette Davis.
Eve, my understudy, I have no idea. Well, well. So Eve is not working for Max after all. Max, you sly puss.
But Eve, Margot, let me tell you about Eve.
I was dreadful, Miss Channing. Believe me, I have no right to be anyone's understudy, much less yours. I'm sure you underestimate yourself, Eve. You always do. You were about to tell me about Eve.
You'd have been proud of her.
I'm sure.
She was a revelation.
Oh, to you too.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, among other things, it must have been a revelation to have a 24-year-old character played by a 24-year-old actress.
Well, that's beside the point.
It is right to the point. Also, it must have seemed so new and fresh to you, so exciting to have your lines read just as you wrote them.
Addison.
So full of meaning, fire, and music.
You knew when you came in that the audition was over, that Eve was your understudy, playing that childish little game of cat and mouse.
Not mouse, never mouse. If anything, rat.
This genius of yours for making a barroom brawl out of a perfectly innocent misunderstanding at most.
Perfectly innocent? Men have been hanged for less. I'm lied to, attacked behind my back, accused of reading your silly dialogue as if it were the holy gospel.
I never said it was.
When you listen as if someone else had written your play, whom do you have in mind? Arthur Miller, Sherwood, Beaumont and Fletcher?
What makes you think either Miller or Sherwood would stand for the nonsense I take from you? You'd better stick to Beaumont and Fletcher. They've been dead for 300 years.
All playwrights should be dead for 300 years.
Shall we just have a cigarette on it?
You like. It's your home, too. There are people here who love you.
They look at you and Tina, share with you peace and contentment.
Of course. And just think it won't be for this time only. That is, if you will help me keep what we have. If we both try hard to protect that little strip of territory that's ours. We can talk about your child.
Our child. Will you be happy, Charlotte?
Oh, Jerry, don't let's ask for the moon. We have the stars.
It is my pleasure to present the man who has guided the American Film Institute since its beginning 10 years ago and helped it to become the internationally respected organization that it is today, the director of the American Film Institute, George Stevens, Jr.
There's a saying, first spoken by a man, I believe, it is less difficult for a woman to become celebrated for her genius than to be forgiven for it. So tonight, we are here to celebrate and forgive a woman of uncommon originality and distinction who, throughout a bold career, dared to be different. In fact, she insisted on it. She dared to appear before the camera with her hair in cold cream, her hair in curlers, cold cream on her face. She dared to stand her ground, becoming one of the first women in motion pictures to shape her career by using the power that her talent had given her. And she dared to test her range as an artist, illuminating for audiences all the women she found within her. A mother, a moll, a dowager, a spinster, a queen, a lover, a shrew, a wife, an actress. She sang, cried, screamed, raged, and killed. Yet always there was something withheld, some emotion in the shadows, which gave dimension to the portraits in the Bette Davis Gallery. The Life Achievement Award is voted by the trustees to an individual who has advanced the art of film and whose work has stood the test of time. We have seen tonight how well Bette Davis's work has met the test of time. The American Film Institute, in collaboration with the National Endowment for the Arts, is pledged to safeguard her films from the ravages of time. 75 Bette Davis films are now preserved in the Library of Congress, so future generations may know and enjoy the artistry of Bette Davis. Before we call her forth, let us look once more and see the faces of Bette Davis as she will be seen now and tomorrow and forever. Gentlemen, Bette Davis.
At the beginning of my career, 48 years ago, how could I have possibly imagined I would be standing here tonight, the recipient of such fabulous compliments for my work? I am truly overcome. The American Film Institute's Life Achievement Award is to me the frosting on the cake of my career. This is a treasured evening that will always be in my heart. I thank all of you who came here to talk about me tonight. In 1926, there was a young girl from Lowell, Massachusetts, who had a dream. She wanted to become an actress. Her name was Ruth Elizabeth Davis, commonly known as Betty. She was not beautiful. She was not tall and willowy. She had a tiny, high-pitched voice that would not have been heard beyond the first row in any theater, but she did have drive and ambition. She did not know whether she had talent or not. She had a great champion who worked in slave for many years to help her dream come true. Without this great champion's belief in her, there never would have been the great success she finally attained. The champion's name was Ruth Favor Davis. She was her mother. How her eyes would have sparkled if she could have been here tonight. In this room tonight are many associates who have helped me along the way. I am grateful to all of you collectively. There are four people, however, I am eternally in debt to. First, George Arliss, who cast me in my first Warner film, The Man Who Played God. Because of this film, I was signed to a contract at Warner Brothers, which lasted 18 years. In spite of some quotes from Mr. Warner, from Miss Minnelli, we really, in the long run, respected each other. I think he finally did respect me. He said so once, anyway. I am truly indebted to Jack Warner, who during all the years gave me the opportunity to have a successful career. He was my professional father. I admit I was often an obstreperous daughter, but he was often an obstreperous father. Next, I am indebted to Hal Wallace, who is head of production under Jack Warner. I thank him for the unbelievable opportunities he gave me as an actress by buying great novels and plays, having scripts written for me. My debt to William Wyler is enormous. He was the first great director I had worked with. Because of his direction of me and his direction of the film, I, for the first time, became a box office star. I often said at that time, if Willie asked me to jump in the Hudson River, I would have. And I would have, Willie. Charles Lawton, a visit at our set when we were making The Private Lives of Elizabeth and Essex. I said to him, I have my nerve attempting to play Elizabeth I, to say nothing of the fact I am only 30 years old and in the script she is 60. He said, never not dare to hang yourself. One must always attempt the impossible if one is to grow as an artist. I am proud I have been privileged to join the ranks of my four predecessors, John Ford, Orson Welles, James Cagney, and William Wyler. I will take second billing to any of them anytime. I'm sure, like me, all of them had dreams that obviously came true. As I say goodnight, I would like to quote my favorite line from all the pictures I have made. I'd love to kiss you, but I just washed my hair.
Tonight's tribute to Bette Davis has been the warm and generous atmosphere here in this room, and we very gratefully acknowledge Terry Stanfield, who arranged it all. On behalf of the American Film Institute, I thank the people here for their contributions to the proceedings. I also thank people everywhere who join us in our great love for the motion picture. And most especially, I thank the actress and the woman who helped turn an industry into an art, Bette Davis.